Earlier this month, the Federal Aviation Administration approved the first training program in the country for electric aviation. The program is just one part of a small but burgeoning effort to develop greener air travel. Our aviation correspondent Miles O'Brien has that report.
Be great. Be great.
It was game day for Nate Moyer.
Seats and books.
A former Air Force test pilot, he was cool as a cucumber facing uncharted airspace ahead. His goal? Fly a new kind of battery-powered aircraft through a tricky transition.
Leah, Chase, area is clear. Pattern is all yours.
It lifted off like a helicopter, but then he stopped the vertical rotors, turning the craft into an airplane. It's called an electric vertical takeoff and landing aircraft, or eVTOL. It was a pivotal moment for a company that hopes to lead the transition away from fossil-fueled flight.
I felt like my purpose was to fly.
Engineer and avid aviator Kyle Clark is the founder and CEO of Beta Technologies, based in Burlington, Vermont.
Somewhere around 30 years old, I had this realization, like, damn, I do genuinely care not only about my own kids, but the future of the world. And that's when I realized that the electric aviation had an outsized importance.
Right now, aviation accounts for about 3% of greenhouse gas emissions globally. But as airline travel increases and other transportation sectors get greener, that piece of the climate emergency pie is growing fast. Is aviation responding quickly enough to this challenge?
In my view, aviation absolutely isn't responding quick enough.
That's because aviation remains skeptical of electric flight. Lithium-ion batteries are about 24 times heavier than jet fuel for the same amount of energy. That might seem like a showstopper for an industry obsessed with weight watching. But the energy density of new lithium-ion batteries improves between 5 and 7% annually, doubling about every 7 years.
That means if we start development today on a 1930, 60 passenger aircraft, it will be flying 1,300 to 1,500 miles by 2032.
The Beta craft is designed to carry cargo or 5 passengers plus pilot with a range of about 250 nautical miles. In October of 2023, a fixed-wing version flew more than 2,000 miles to the Florida Panhandle. Flight test engineer Emma Davis coordinated the multi-leg journey.
You can get in it, you can fly in it, you can carry cargo in it. This aircraft isn't a gimmick, it is a real-world aircraft. It is reliable, it can be ready and available to pick up missions as needed.
Proving that is why they brought the eVTOL here to Duke Field. This is where the Air Force does its helicopter flight testing. The Pentagon is interested in seeing how well eVTOLs might suit its needs in moving personnel, cargo, or on medevac missions. Colonel Tom Maher is with the Air Force Innovation Lab, AFWERCS.
So the things that we want to learn is, how do you operate an electric aircraft? So that includes not only the infrastructure, but the maintenance personnel, operations, the charging. We want to learn about all those facets that we previously don't have experience with.
Over the course of 3 months, they flew about 100 test missions to civilian and military airports in Florida, Georgia, and Alabama, testing its performance in the air and attached to chargers. It had a near 100% dispatch rate. The Pentagon hopes to bolster a flourishing, homegrown electric aviation industry. A decade ago, the Federal Aviation Administration moved too slowly, and China took the lead on commercial drone technology. It has not looked back.
We want to make sure that did not happen with this part of the emerging aviation sector. So it was critical that we establish these companies within the U.S. so that we have them not only for near-term use, but also down the line for not only government use, but also commercial use cases.
But when it comes to electric aviation, China is not slowing down. The country dominates lithium-ion battery production and has already certified 1 fixed-wing electric airplane and 2 eVTOL models. eVTOL manufacturers are designing their aircraft to be flown autonomously, but it is far from certain when the Federal Aviation Administration might approve that. So at first, Beta's aircraft will fly with a pilot on board, carrying cargo. UPS is a customer, as is United Therapeutics, a biotech company focused partly on organ transplantation. Eventually, Beta envisions unpiloted missions, carrying both cargo and passengers.
Uh-huh. This prop right here, obviously it's not pushing a motor or an engine, so it spins freely.
Kyle Clark gave me a tour of Beta's production facility, where they aim to build 300 aircraft a year, a big number in the world of aviation.
We have aspirations of building more aircraft than that. There's a lot of folks in this industry that are talking about thousands of aircraft per year, and we believe we're going to get there as well.
One of the market leaders in the U.S., Santa Cruz, California-based Joby, is aiming to build thousands of eVTOL aircraft that could serve as flying taxis in traffic-strangled megacities.
We're excited about the day when this becomes part of people's daily lives.
JoBen Bivert is the founder and CEO of Joby.
Our goal is absolutely to drive it down over time to something that's affordable for many people to use on a regular basis.
Delta Airlines has invested $60 million in Joby. The airline envisions flying its customers on Joby eVTOLs to and from the three existing heliports in Manhattan to JFK Airport. But Delta CEO Ed Bastian says his company also invested to learn about electric flight and how it could be applied to reach Delta's 2050 net carbon zero goal for its entire fleet.
It's highly ambitious. If I said I had a pathway to that, I'd be kidding myself. We're a hard-to-abate sector, as defined. I mean, we just don't have a substitute for jet fuel currently.
The race to find a practical alternative will force federal regulators to explore and grasp some technologies that are new to aviation. Michael Huerta was the FAA administrator from 2013 to 2018. He now sits on the boards of Joby and Delta.
It's not going to be sufficient to say this is how we've always done it. We really need to be thinking about what are new ways to get aircraft certified, to get pilots into the system, and to enable operations for what will be a growing segment of the aviation industry.
But there could be a solution that would reduce aviation's carbon footprint in the near term while it charts a course to a truly carbon zero future. And the grease in this dumpster is a key part of that story. We'll serve up more on that in our next installment. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Miles O'Brien in Boston.